Even though we know the end game of the globalist, we must remember God remains in control.
And the religion is the religion of leftism. It's the Babylonian religion. It's the religion of 180ism. It's wokeism. It's everything that's opposite of the Bible, right? That's Babylonianism. It's man-made religion.
Welcome to Understanding the Times Radio with Jen Markell, Radio for the Remnant, brought to you by Olive Tree Ministries. Today, Jan visits with Pastor Brandon Holdhouse of Rock Harbor Church in Bakersfield, California. The globalists are trying to reset the world to form their new world order. How do we stand for righteousness amidst this growing darkness? Here is today's programming.
The real principle you need to work with and understand is this. The people, the group that is behind all of what's happening, the lockdowns, the vaccines, the globalism, all this other stuff, want to destroy Western society, okay? They want to destroy Western society, including America. America is the prize. They want to destroy Western society to be able to usher in what they want to bring into the world. And what they're wanting to bring into the world is globalism, okay? That's the main understanding that you have in all of this, okay? And so to really get a grasp of it, you have to first start there. What's the ultimate goal? Their ultimate goal is globalism. Now, you and I as prophecy students understand that that goal is mentioned in Scripture, that they will form a one world government. And eventually that one world government falls into the hands of the Antichrist and he takes over. And by the midpoint of the tribulation, he's in full control of the entire globe. So this is where it's going. So we know this as prophecy students. We know the end game. We know the end result of what they're wanting to do. So when you see things start happening in our world and it just looks insane, why are they doing this? This doesn't make sense. It's because it is a stair step to globalism.
And welcome to the program. So glad you can join me today. I used that little minute clip of my guest, Pastor Brandon Holdhouse, as I felt it would set the stage for an hour's discussion today on just what on earth is happening. Do you ever wonder who is behind some of the troubling things going on right now, from even wokeism of our military leaders, the Afghanistan debacle, the trans agenda, even the vaccine agenda? Who's behind this? Well, the short answer would be the world's globalists, those pushing for one world government. We talk about that very frequently on Understanding the Times Radio with various guests that I've had over the years. Who are the players in the global agenda? Frankly, I have a whole DVD on that. We can't get into the real details, but here's just a quick rundown. The prominent players would be the World Economic Forum, Big Tech, United Nations, the World Bank, international bankers for that matter, the Council on Foreign Relations, the Trilateral Commission, the Bilderbergers, those pushing Agenda 21, which quite frankly is set aside now for heading into Agenda 2030, though I think that Agenda 2030 has been moved up to just a couple of years out now. And then last on my short list, but not the least, would be the Green New Deal pushers, the whole environmentalist climate change people, which I believe this is going to be the religion of the New World Order. The religion of the globalists would be the Green New Deal. So these are just some of the players on the scorecard today. Just how they're playing out, it's a complicated scenario that would take literally a book or an extensive DVD teaching to fully explain. But my guest, Pastor Brandon Holdhouse, and I are going to try to unpack what we can in just a little bit under an hour today on Understanding the Times Radio. Pastor Brandon, welcome back to the program.
Thanks for having me again.
Let's continue to set the stage, Brandon. Now, there are a few folks in the way of these One World Agenda folks, and they would be capitalists, Christians, probably patriots. Anybody I'm missing there?
No, I think the whole paradigm of the Judeo-Christian system, which is part of Western society, even though it's waning in these later years, that's the one thing they have to destroy, is that Judeo-Christian ethic, morals, and principles in order to usher in their globalism. And they've been doing a very good job at it. So they have captured basically every sector of society in order to do this, whether it's the media, politics, education, obviously, entertainment industry, big tech, big corp. And basically, when you have all that, and along with the banking institutions, you have secured yourself in all the information avenues that could come our way. So that's why we shouldn't be shocked, whether it's a politician, academia, right, or Hollywood, giving us the same talking points for forming a global government. They all say the same thing.
You recently even participated in a conference co-sponsored by Lamline Ministries and Pastor Billy Crone's ministry on the Great Reset. I saw portions of that conference. I watched your entire message and some others as well. You talk frequently about going back to the Babylonian system, because that's what we're doing as we speak. We're heading back to the Babylonian system. But why don't you explain what you mean by that?
If you study ancient Babylon under Nimrod, and then you study the other passages in Scripture about the prophecies concerning Babylon, specifically look at Revelation 17 and 18 mm-hmm. about Babylon, what you will notice that Babylon is going to be reformed again. It's going to be the center where the Antichrist makes his headquarters. And I believe it's going to be exactly where the Tower of Babel was built. God seems to bring everything back to where it started. The aspect of Babylon, if you study it in Scripture, you will notice that there's three legs to mm-hmm. it, and it's very prominent. One is an economic leg, which would include businesses, banks, corporations, big tech. The other one is a political leg, referring to the kings of the earth, which involves the nations and other global regions. And then the other one is a religious leg, which we call the Whore of Babylon. So Babylon has this three-legged stool, as you call it, and for it to function, it has to have all three legs. So when you put that template on what they're doing today, you will see the three legs involved. You will see the morality of Babylon through its religion. Then you will see the economics pushing towards one world economic system, digital currency. And then you'll see the politics involved, where all the nations are on the same page right now, wanting global mm-hmm. governance. So that's how we're to understand this scripturally.
Here's the one thing that the global government folks really, really need. They need chaos and they need a crisis. This is a clip of you, Brandon, from your recent conference presentation that I'm going to play.
And then cause as much chaos and crisis to introduce authoritarian control, to get order out of chaos. See, Satan is very smart, and he uses these tools in his hands to say, look, create enough chaos, people will be begging for somebody, a strong person, to come in and take order out of things. We've got to have order. So it's intentional that you see chaos, because then they can use that and say, well, you're right, it's chaotic. But in order for us to get control of this, we're going to ask you to give up your rights. So you just give up your rights and we'll get this thing figured out. That's what they're going to do. And that's what they've been doing. Never let a crisis go to waste. Remember, Rahm Emanuel said that?
That's what we've been watching play out here for the last year and a half, soon going on 2 years. A virus comes along, instills fear in people. I have a suspicion that another crisis is on the horizon, and I want to ask you about that in just a moment. But the point is, what they're doing is they're getting folks to get nervous and anxious enough so that whoever will come along and offer order out of chaos will be honored. You and I know that's ultimately the Antichrist. Well, there are some Antichrist-esque people right now on the planet who are trying to do the same thing. Klaus Schwab, World Economic Forum, etc., priming the pump. But like you say, there has to be chaos and there has to be fear. And it's been a brilliant plan. It's been quite successful.
It sure has. And we call this in intelligence agencies and CIA type stuff, they call this a psychological operation, mm-hmm. a psychops. That's exactly what it is. And obviously Satan is using it. But when you do a psychological operation, what they call it is a reaction solution technique. That's the technique. And that's what they've been perpetrating. So you cause a crisis, the people are going to have a reaction, and then you offer the solution.
Yes.
But in all the solutions, is to take more freedoms from the individual for what? Peace and security.
That's right.
And that's a phrase we know from the Bible that Paul talks about. in 1 Thessalonians 5, that when they say peace and safety or peace and security, then sudden destruction comes upon them. That's what they're using. Hey, we will give you peace and security, whether that's financial, health, chaos in the streets. We will give you peace and security, but you have to give us some of your liberty. And that's the game they're playing. And what we have watched, and this has been very upsetting, is watch people give up their liberties that people died for in our country in order to have their so-called life back.
Talking to Pastor Brandon Holthaus, he pastors Rock Harbor Church in Bakersfield, California. You can find more information at his website, rockharborchurch.net. I had the privilege of ministering there on a couple of occasions. This would have been a year ago now. Brandon, so the point is, nationalism has to go, and of course we know the ultimate nationalist was former President Donald Trump, and replace with global citizenry. That is what the agenda is as we speak.
Yeah, it sure is. And you can see from Scripture, when God divided the people from the Tower of Babel, he did it through language, and he divided them up into nations. So since then, we can see God wanting individual nations. The old marker of that is language, culture, borders.
Yes.
And that's typically how the Bible defines a nation. Israel's job was to reach all the nations. So national sovereignty is a biblical concept. Mm-hmm. Borders are a biblical concept. Language is a biblical concept. But now what they're trying to do is erase borders, mm-hmm. erase language, and erase any type of patriotism you would have towards your own country. And calling that racist or xenophobic, that's why we're now seeing no borders, a porous border where people just pour in, because what we're seeing is a replacement of national sovereignty. This happened in Europe. They had a great replacement, and now it's happening to the United States.
Yes.
So this is the agenda.
They're creating tribalism. In other words, loyalty to their tribal group rather than being an American. And this falls under the category of divide and conquer. It's heartbreaking, Brandon, and you're out there on the West Coast, not all that far from the border, and it has to be heartbreaking to see. I'm here in Minnesota, and we have had an influx of immigrants from all over, but heavily from the Muslim world, and I think you're getting them heavily from the South America, Mexico, etc., correct?
Yeah, and what it's done is America was supposed to be a melting pot. So you come here from any place, we're open to immigration, but you have to assimilate. So what they have done, as far as their agenda in the schools and universities, is tell people that come into America, you don't have to be American. You need to be loyal to your skin color, loyal to your tribe, and not assimilate. And that's what's happened in places all over the United States, whether it's in your area or my area with a southern border, or Muslims being put in pockets of cities, and they don't assimilate. That is intentional because they want them loyal to their skin color, their nationality, but not loyal to America. Divide and conquer.
Yeah.
And that's what we have here. Now, no one's loyal to America.
Correct. That would be the goal eventually, yes. This is the plan being perpetrated by the World Economic Forum, the world's globalists. Brandon, when you had your conference on World Economic Forum, this is a few weeks ago now, and I believe this was at Pastor Crone's church, and I think each speaker presented a various angle on the World Economic Forum. And as I said earlier, I watched as many as I could. It was excellent information. In your lifetime, did you ever expect to see the rise of what we're watching? We're watching the rise of this end-time rebirth of the Babylonian system, the effort, again, Nimrod tried it many thousands of years ago. But here we're seeing the world's globalists try to perpetrate a new world order, but it's not God's new world order.
I think it caught a lot of us by surprise.
It did me.
Because we've always known about a global government that would form in the tribulation. But I think what caught us off guard a little bit was how much of the setup would happen during the church age.
During the church age.
And we're seeing an alarming amount of setup. We're having to readjust our perspective on there's a shadow being cast over the church age, and we're watching a lot of things we didn't expect to happen. So when I'm doing a conference talking about the political aspects of the Great Reset, I never dreamed I would have to go that deep into being able to try to explain what they're currently doing. Because a lot of us just said, man, that's going to be in the tribulation.
Yeah.
We're not going to see a lot of that. But here we are.
God's giving us a heads up. I think he's also giving us a reminder that it's absolutely later than we could possibly imagine. I'm heading here into a related topic, just a little bit different, and I referenced it minutes ago, and that is the religion of the New World Order, which is going to be the Green Agenda, and the whole global warming, climate change, as though man has the ability to change climate, which is laughable in certain sense. There's so many verses in the Bible that God alone controls the weather. Nevertheless, this whole idol of ecology has come along in the last 40 years. I'm playing a clip of you right now because you made reference to For the Sake of the Planet, and it's a roadmap to build a climate-resistant economy, and it's a 40-page report that's online. I'm going to have you tell us where it is online here in a moment, but I'm going to play. It's 2 minutes. And then I want to come back and I want to discuss it because I personally feel that this whole green agenda is just huge as it is setting the stage for the Antichrist and his empire and worshiping the earth.
Now you have the Biden administration that's like rubber stamping everything the globalists want, everything that the reset, the Davos people want. So basically on Friday, the Great Reset people and the UN just received their support from the United States. And now, basically, the United States is going to be implementing this economic framework. This is pivotal. This is a crucial moment. This is where you're seeing goodbye to capitalism, okay? And basically, they're going to reset the U.S. economy to be an economy based on a fake issue, global warming. And it's going to be a resource economy, okay? So, again, what does the World Economic Forum want? What does the Great Reset want? It wants to take away, ultimately, everybody's ability to own private property, okay? And that's why they say in the Great Reset, you won't own anything by 2030. You'll just rent everything. Basically turn everyone into slaves. And they're going to do this, convince people of the world not to own anything, to just rent everything for the sake of the planet, for the sake of gas, carbon gas emissions, greenhouse gases. So they're going to convince people to give up their private property or either force them to, but that's where this is going. So now you have seen the first implementation, the stair step towards this, and it starts with shaming people, shaming businesses into compliance because they know they can't do it legally. So in this 40-page report called The Roadmap to Build a Climate-Resilient Economy, you can read it for yourself. Go to documentcloud.org from the government website. You can read it there. It's all right there in front of everybody to read. It talks about restructuring the U.S. economy based on, obviously, this pseudo climate change hoax. And basically said that, you know, climate change is a national security all of a sudden. It's a national security. They've ramped it up to this level that it's an existential threat. Oh, no, not Iran, not North Korea, not China, not Russia, but climate change. How stupid. And yet people will believe that.
Very good point, Brandon Holthouse, and that is they've ramped climate change, which, as you say, is non-existent other than what God does. He changes climate on a 24-hour basis. They've ramped it up to be a national security issue. You talk about end-time strong delusion. This is a good example of it here, the things you've just shared, same category, delusion.
And that's where you start seeing the religious element in it, like you mentioned,
yes.
Because it's totally irrational. It's not based on facts and science, and we know this. We've known that man-made carbon emissions doesn't affect the environment. And we've known that for years. The whole thing has been debunked. So they had to change it from global warming to climate change and blame everything on man's carbon emissions. It's a hoax. But nonetheless, what you start realizing is this has turned into a religion. Because it's a religion, what they have proposed is their form of the apocalypse. That we're all going to die, the planet's going to burn up, Mother Earth needs help, and we all got to do our part. So this is a religion of existential threat that we need to help Mother Earth. We all need to do our part. So therefore, we will exact taxes or money from you in order to pay for this existential threat. This is why Biden got us back into the Paris Accords, where we send billions of dollars to be redistributed to third world countries, because we got to pay our fair share. But eventually, what's going to happen, they're going to use this on an individual level because of this religion. They're going to say, hey, look, we have your credit card, your gas card, and you've driven too much this month, so we're going to stop you and your ability to get gas for your car. That's where it's going. It's even going to come to buying things. If you buy certain things that gives a carbon footprint, well, you're only going to be allowed a certain carbon footprint for the month. And then once you reach that carbon level, you're stopped in buying that. That's where this is going. This is a fanatical, false religion, and it has apocalyptic tones to it. And this is what they're doing, creating another crisis. And the way we're going to solve it is take from you, your private property, your money, your wealth, to stop this existential threat.
Very well stated, Brandon. Talking to Brandon Holthouse for the hour. Again, you can find more information about his church, Rock Harbor Church in Bakersfield, at rockharborchurch.net. I have had him on a number of times. And Brandon, you take the prize for getting my program taken off of a certain platform when I have you on.
Sorry.
You and Pastor Billy Crone specialize in that. I really appreciate that a whole lot. I think this is playing out in a huge fashion here as we wind the church age down and head into, quite frankly, the tribulation is casting a shadow on the church age all the time. That shadow is more prominent than people realize. But I think this is going to be one of the idols of the tribulation, is this earth worship. Talks about that in Romans 8. And really considers that an abomination. Not that we shouldn't be taking care of creation. I get really upset when people hear us suggest that that's what we're suggesting, is that we not take care of creation. That is the last thing I happen to be saying. It's just that the whole movement has been perverted and taken to an extreme and turned out to become earth worship instead of worshiping God.
Exactly. And for Christians to understand the difference, God calls us to be stewards of the creation. But we're not to be slaves of the creation. What they're wanting to do in radical environmentalism is worship the creation.
Yeah.
Christians are for conservation, which is, yeah, everyone wants clean water and clean air, of course. But when you make up fake things that all of a sudden carbon emissions is a poison, then we're not to comply with lies.
Mm-hmm.
We're not to participate in those types of lies. We get lumped into, oh, you Christians just don't care about the environment.
Right.
You're for pollution. You're for unclean water. That's not right. We don't worship the creation. But what you're seeing now is the actual worship of creation, which is what Romans 1 is talking about. And therefore, what will come from that? When people do that, all you have to do is look at Romans 1, and he explains the vices, the immorality that will actually come from that. So when you see how crazy morally and immoral these people are in our world, it's a telltale sign that they're worshiping the creation.
Mm-hmm.
And it's nothing but ancient paganism. That's all it is. And basically, Babylon returns people back to worshiping the creation rather than God. That's the whole intent. So this is ingenious of Satan in
yes.
one sense, because Satan realizes that he has to have a glue to stick people together because of nationalism, and it's hard to get people to be more globally oriented. He has to do it through a false religion. And what better false religion than creation care, worshiping yeah. creation, to be the glue that links everyone together?
Right. And what's troubled me is even in the last 10, 15, 20 years, I've seen evangelical outfits form these ecological organizations. And again, it's fine to encourage us to take care of creation. I have no problem with that whatsoever. But what I'm seeing, Brandon, then the pulpits that are behind this are preaching ecology instead of you must be born again. And these are evangelical outfits. It's not your normal mainline Protestant liberalism. It's evangelicals preaching ecology over you must be born again. So it's more signs of the times in Laodicea.
It sure is, and we're seeing more and more of that. And here's the scary part. We're going to see even more, because when they start mandating this from the government,
yeah.
and we're going to see imperialism happen in the United States, where the UN is telling us what to do and taxing us, what's going to happen is a lot of the churches that are like this now of creation care. I mean, like, I heard one church interpret John 3:16 as the world referring not to people, but the planet.
Yeah.
God so loved the planet.
Yes.
And it's like, okay, man, you're out of your mind interpreting it like that. But that's what they do. Or I saw another church have an altar call. And the altar call wasn't to get saved, but the church had put up barrels of dirt.
That's right.
In the front, and they asked people to come forward, grab a handful of dirt, and make your promise that you're going to do everything you can to save the planet. That's what you're talking about.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. And I'm not talking about it in the First Unitarian Church. Some of these things we're talking about in First Baptist Church in you fill in the blank cities. That's why I'm troubled by what we're talking about. Here's where I want to go yet. I want to talk a little bit in part two of my programming about this social credit score. It's right now very prominent in China, but the point is it's coming to the Western world. I would suspect it would be in America within a year, and you need to understand what it is. I'm going to play a couple of clips about it to help you better understand it. You might have heard the term your ESG score. Well, what is that all about? And is that going to be a good thing or a bad thing? I promise you, anything that is being perpetrated by the globalists of this world is nefarious. And you need to look at all of this in a suspicious manner. So what we're trying to do this hour is help you better understand just what the globalists are up to. And one of the things that's going to be coming down the pike, we don't know when, but I would suspect very soon, you will get a social credit score. What does that mean? What will that allow you to do or not to do? Just how is that going to affect your day-to-day living? Because it will. And you'll hear how it's affecting those in China as we speak. So I'm going to get into that as soon as we get back. I'm going to take a very short time out. Back in a minute or two. Don't go away.
What is the Great Reset? Obviously, there's a couple things I want to mention. It is the World Economic Forum's name for it, the UN's name for their goal of creating the globalist system, a one world government, one world economy, one world religion. Pretty easy to understand at the base level, but that's what they're attempting. Well, how does it fit into Bible prophecy? Real simple. If you turn to Revelation 17 and 18, you will see the revived Babylonian system that plays itself out all through the tribulation. And then just to use this verse, Revelation 18:3, it says, "For all the nations have drunk the wine of the wrath of her, the whore of Babylon," the religious aspect of her, her fornication. "The kings of the earth," that would be the politicians, the leaders, the globalists, "have committed fornication with her. And the merchants of the earth," the businessmen, big tech, big corp, have become rich through the abundance of her luxury." So there's the key aspect. There's the three-legged aspect of the Babylonian system. And so there's the system. The merchants of the world, they are big business. They are your Mark Zuckerbergs. They are your Amazon. They are your all these big corporations and big tech that are involved in this. Blackstone, other kinds of major corporations, international corporations. The kings, obviously, rulers, politicians, global elites, they're all involved in this. And then the religious aspect is among us today. The religious aspect can be called lawlessness or 180ism. Now, why did I say that? Because lawlessness doesn't mean anarchy. It simply means that they're going to do everything opposite of what God says. God says this is right. They say this is wrong. It's 180ism. That's the system of lawlessness. So that's why you see wokeism about everything. You see the pushing of immorality. And then when you act like they want you to act, that cleanses you from all their sins. The way you atone in their system is bow a knee and proclaim that they have the truth and you have to submit to their values. That's how you get cleansed. If not, they cancel you. This is the way it goes in the Babylonian system. They have their own set of morality. They have their own high priest class. They have their own sacrifices. And they have their own infidels. That means you and I. We are the infidels in that system. But it is satanic.
And welcome back. You're listening to Understanding the Times Radio. That's the voice of my guest for the hour, Pastor Brandon Holthaus. You can find out more at his website, which is rockharborchurch.net. He headquarters out of Bakersfield, California. I got to meet the wonderful people at Rock Harbor Church in January a year ago. I was ministered there a couple of times. By the way, folks, we are very active on social media. Check it out, won't you? Find us on Telegram, on Facebook, on Gab, Instagram, Rumble, YouTube. join the conversation there. My goodness, thousands of people are talking to each other and about all the issues that are going on in the world. Again, it's a big lineup of Telegram, Facebook, Gab, Instagram, Rumble, YouTube. You can always dialogue with me if you want to write me through the website, olivetreeviews.org, olivetreeviews.org. Don't forget, we have a video version of this program. So if you want to see the things we're talking about, you want to see the clips we're playing, etc., you can find that. We post it to Rumble. We post it to YouTube. Most important, we post it to our website, olivetreeviews.org, olivetreeviews.org, both the audio and the video. Now, I mentioned in part one of the programming that I wanted to talk a little bit about the social credit score, which is, as we speak, flourishing in China. And I think what I need to do is play a short clip, and it's describing exactly how it plays out in China. Now, the question is, when does this come to the Western world, and what are the implications of it playing out in your city, in my city, say in Canada, in America? Because it will have tremendous implications once it hits the Western world, and many feel that is within the next year or so. So I'm going to play this very short clip, and then we'll come back, and I'm going to talk about it with my guest, Pastor Brandon Holthaus.
Everywhere she goes, Ouyang Haoyu is followed. What she buys, how she behaves, is tracked and scored to show how responsible and trustworthy she is. It's called the social credit system, and in one version now being tested, a person's reputation is scored on a scale of 350 to 950. And Haoyu, with a good score of 752, is okay with it. In fact, most people are.
It's a mechanism like pushes you to become a better citizen.
It's big data meets big brother, expanding how the government monitors, understands, and ultimately controls its 1.4 billion citizens. Thanks to advances in artificial intelligence and facial recognition, and a web of more than 200 million surveillance cameras.
Are people bothered by privacy concerns?
We think a lot of camera keep the safety is really good. We can accept it.
Companies are experimenting with the algorithms to help the government create the new national social credit system. The government also has pilot projects. In one, citizens are required to do hours of unpaid work to get benefits. And scores are docked for things like littering, a messy yard, gossip, even jaywalking. Video of offenders is shown on the local news. And information collectors like Zhou Aini are paid to report on their neighbors, her quota, 10 entries a month. Like the man who carried a drunk person home, a good deed, she says. Good social credit gets rewarded with perks like cheap loans and travel deals. But a bad score means public shame and worse.
Brandon Holthaus, I picked out several things in that little clip that jumped out at me. One gentleman said, well, this is helping our safety, so it's good, trading all sorts of things for the illusion of safety. But we have something going on now called the ESG, Environmental, Social, and Governance. How would you compare this social credit score that we just heard this little minute and a half clip about with the ESG score that's either being implemented perhaps as we speak because we've got credit card companies and more who are jumping on the bandwagon of this kind of technology?
I think when you saw China's social credit score, that was the prototype.
Yes.
For what they wanted to use globally. What they have come up with is what you call the ESG score, the environmental, social, and governance. That will be what your reputation is based on. And they have already gotten all the international banking and most of the national banks here in the United States on board on this, that they will be implementing ESG scores. Now, right now, it's not on the personal one-on-one level, but the stair step is this. It's at the banking level and who the banks do business mm-hmm. with. And this is critical to understand. They can't legislate this, so they have to do it through the corporations and banking. And basically, it works like this. If a bank is ESG compliant, then it will only give loans to other companies who are also ESG compliant. You will only do business with other companies who are ESG. If you're not, you're shamed and you're told to explain why are you not ESG, and you're outed from doing business with other people. So this is how they're going to do it on the business level. But eventually it comes to the personal level. And the personal level is going to hit us like it's hitting people in China. Mm-hmm. And if your environmental score, your social score, and your governance score is not adequate, here's how it will eventually affect you. You won't be able to go to certain schools or colleges. You won't be able to take out certain loans from ESG-compliant banks. You won't be able to purchase, buy, and selling certain things, particularly things that could help you, maybe food or even protection through buying guns and ammo if your ESG score is low. You won't be able to travel. This is what happens in China. They can't use the bus, they can't use the railway, and they can't fly. This is all coming on a personal level faster than what people know. It's at the banking level right now. It's at the corporate level, but it's coming to a customer near you.
Please note, you won't be able to buy or sell without a good social credit score. Folks, this is apocalyptic. So big corporations are all in, and perhaps conveniently, some middle class mom and pop stores have been put out of business because of the pandemic and other reasons as well. Middle class businesses are struggling. Tens of thousands are going out of business as we speak. Are they even going to be a player? Or if they don't go along with this, will the balance of them be put out of business?
Yeah, the whole deal is about this. This is why corporations complied with this and banking. They said, look, the smaller businesses, the medium-sized businesses are not going to be able to comply with this. Because as far as governance is concerned, you have to have boards and leaders and managers mm-hmm. and supervisors, not based on merit, not based on experience in the industry, but based on the sexual orientation of the individual, the skin color, other wokeisms that you have to have on your company. Most companies can't do that because it'll destroy them as far as their governance is concerned. As anyone would know in common sense, you're going to run a company, you want the best people. You want them based on meritocracy and education and experience. But now they're saying, no, you need to have a percentage of this type of individual, that type of individual, and that will destroy business. So basically, here's what the game is, to put small business and medium businesses out of business so that the big corporations monopolize the entire market. That's why these corporations and banks are willing to comply, because they're able to make billions of dollars through this.
So that small business goes out of business, but business continues to prosper and doubly prosper.
That's right. So the big businesses are willing to take a little hit now, but for big money later when everyone goes out of business.
I'm going back to the social credit system again. That's in China. Tell me, where is the ESG system right now as we speak?
The ESG system is at the banking level, the international banking level. So if you bank at a particular bank that does business overseas, just simply ask your own bank, do you comply with ESG scores? And they'll tell you. And a lot of the banks already do. That's where it's at, that level. It's not going to stay there. The goal is to get it to one-on-one to affect the individual to be compliant. Okay. And so here's what they're going to be able to say. Well, we're not putting any laws on you. This is not coming from the government, but your bank requires it. So if you want a home loan, you better be ESG compliant if you want this home loan. And if you're not, then we can't loan you the money. I'm sorry. So this is where the social credit score, it's going to be combined with like your credit card score. And it's going to be used in concert with that. Basically, what are you doing to do your part to save the planet? What are you doing as far as practicing wokeism and social justice? And what are you doing in your own business of incorporating transgender, LGBT quotas for how you do business? And that's how you're going to be judged. That's the social credit scores coming.
Now, would this be a part of the agenda then of the World Economic Forum, probably?
Yes, it is. Yeah. It's part and parcel of it. It's like these guys got all together and they made this kind of agenda. This is what we're going to do. So if you look at even the UN, the Secretary General Antonio Guterres just came out and introduced a common agenda. It's all in the common agenda.
Yeah, I want to go there because that's actually something in my notes I was going to bring up. I looked it up. Our common agenda, UN head Guterres proposes a 2023 summit of the future in our common agenda. Let me just read a paragraph about our common agenda. It's everything we're talking about here this hour, folks. And they say promoters of our common agenda, this is being targeted for 2023. Well, we're almost at 2022, folks. They say this is a critical year in signaling whether we have a global community or a tribal planet. It will tell us whether individually and collectively we look to physical, political, and social borders as defining self-interest, or whether we have the willingness and find ways to go beyond. We need to recognize that the better choice is all of us coming together and doing common cause to prevent and contain the economic, social, and political viruses we all face. This is where our common agenda, a major United Nations report, comes in, showing us why this is a pivotal moment for the planet and how to move forward. What I'm reading between the lines, Brandon Holthaus, Guterres here, our common agenda, I think they're targeting 2023. That's what they have in everything I've been reading here. So this is just another great leap forward effort towards one worldism. Here again, they're not hiding it. They're proud of it. They're not ashamed of it. This is something that everybody on the planet should be aspiring to, is one worldism.
Yeah. Anybody can read this. You just go to UN.org and look up Common Agenda, and it's there for anyone to see. And they actually tell you, just like you're saying, they don't hide this. They tell you. When you read all these points, they have like 12 points. The ESG score that you and I are talking about is embedded in all of this. Because what do they want? They want more teeth, more legal ability to force these UN mandates on other countries for what? Sustainable development, climate action, inequality. That's the wokeism stuff. Sexual discrimination, racial discrimination. There's the critical race theory. There's the transgender LGBT movement. It's all embedded in this. And they want to push this on through imperialistic mechanisms onto other countries, which, Jan, goes right back to what the Roman Empire was doing. It's imperialism. So you and I one day will be in the United States. We're not raptured anytime soon. And we're going to see imperialism coming from the UN telling us about our ESG scores and docking us money and taxes in order to pay for all of this.
At one time, it seemed, Brandon, that the target date for a lot of this was 2030. There's even Agenda 2030. I think they were aspiring to have a global change in 2030. I'm wondering if this has been ramped up a whole lot. Now I'm reading 2023. That's what this agenda we're talking about here, our common agenda. The goal is 2023. I'm just wondering if the globalists have upped the ante and moved the date much closer to us than 2030. Do you get that impression?
I do. And the test case of where I'm getting my impression is the last 2 years.
Yes.
I think they saw with the pandemic how easy it was to maneuver this.
Okay.
And I think they used that as a template saying, well, let's just get everything accomplished because people are just taking it. People are just not fighting back. Oh, yeah, there's a few protests in here, but by and large, most people are not pushing back on this. So I think the last 2 years is the way we have to view this. Therefore, they have kicked this thing into high gear, and they are going for it. So I believe things are going to develop faster than what people think.
I think you're right, which is a good word of warning to my audience. And I think what we need to do, Brandon, is spend just a moment here. We've spent 3/4 of a program with some kind of bleak news, and I think we need to present the more encouraging angle to all of this. Of course, the thing that leaps out in my mind when it comes to the positive angle is all of this is a herald of his coming. All of this is reminding us that the tribulation is just over a fence post. You can almost hear the hoofbeats of the four horsemen of the apocalypse. And you and I believe in a pre-tribulation rapture. The church is removed before all of the terrible hell breaks loose. That is certainly forming. But you go ahead. I'd like you to encourage my audience as well. And I know you do that very well.
One of the things we have to keep in mind as prophecy students is we're going to have a bittersweet element to prophecy. Just like when John was told to swallow the small scroll in Revelation 10, it's bitter to watch all this happen to our world. It's horrible to watch. But at the same time, there's a sweetness about it. The sweetness is God is allowing this to head to the tribulation to get his son on the throne and to rule for 1,000 years.
Yes.
That's what this is all about. So we're getting closer to Jesus' ruling and reigning after the second coming. It also signals to us that we're getting closer to being taken away in the rapture. When I look at this, yeah, there's that bittersweet element, but you got to keep the sweetness in mind. We're closer to seeing the Lord. Then what we need to do from all of that with the bittersweet element is to understand this is supposed to prepare us. Prophecy is to prepare us, not scare us. And therefore, how do I prepare, Brandon? Well, if things are going to escalate with birth pains becoming closer in time and bigger, I need to prepare spiritually for that. Well, what do you mean? It means that I need to be about my Father's business. I need to be working and finishing well. I need to be able to cross that finish line and give it everything I had until we're taken home. It's not a time to surrender. It's not a time to sit on the spiritual couch and do nothing. It is time, and the urgency calls for us to get out, evangelize, disciple, be a watcher on the wall, and be the warning. Now, people will say, well, what's the point, Brandon? Is this going to end in the tribulation anyway? What's the point? Well, we have to think in terms of what the prophets were called to do. Many times the prophets, like Jeremiah, were called to do something, and God told Jeremiah, I want you to go tell them this, but they're not going to listen to you. But we got to tell them. Why? Because we have to give a warning for those maybe who will come to faith, but still a warning to put others who will refuse to listen, to put them on notice. God is gracious in getting these warnings out to people, and he knows whether they're going to hear or not. But that's not our job. Our job is to warn. So we have a job to do. We have a mission to complete. And so our mission's not complete until we're taken home. So the encouraging part of this is we were all called to such a time as this, so we need to get active. We need to be about what God wants us to do and finish well and fight the good fight of faith.
Very well said, Brandon. You recently ministered at a prophecy conference put on by Pastor Billy Crone, Lamblion Ministries, and I ministered very recently at Behold, He Comes, Pastor Jack Hibbs, Calvary Chapel, Chino Hills, California. We both met a lot of people in the process and heard their stories. Not that we don't hear from them by email and by snail mail as well. Get a lot of emails expressing a lot of frustrations with the church today. And it would seem that the church today, not all, we certainly know there are good churches out there, and just thrilled whenever I get a note saying I'm a part of a wonderful Bible preaching church, and it even talks about the fact that the king is coming. But they are in the minority. I know when you talk to some folks at the conference you were at, folks would come up to you and say, I'm in a solid church, but it just will not go in some important areas that it's just leaving out. Let's put it that way. They will not talk about the Lord's soon return, about the fact that all the things that are breaking in the news on a daily basis, that's quite frankly right out of the Bible, because the Bible predicted all these terrible things that are breaking on a daily basis. So how do you talk to folks like that then?
I say, thank God that you have at least a solid church, because most people
can't find
a solid church, so that's first of all. But I tell them, look, I understand that your pastor's either not willing to go there or doesn't have the ability to go there, so you're going to have to supplement. You're going to have to supplement by listening to people like Jan Markell and Billy Crone and Tom Hughes and Jack Hibbs and J.D. Farag. You're going to have to supplement with those other guys who are able to connect dots for you if your pastor's not willing. So you're just going to have to accept that if it's at least a decent church. And they're okay with that, and that's fine. It's not what we would want. We want these churches to help equip the saints, but they're not being equipped for this season. So you have to just turn them to other resources.
But you are doing some networking, and we talked about it last time you were on air with me, some many months ago now. You are helping folks to find some churches. I think they can even email you, and you'll try to get them plugged in. Why don't you give yourself another little bit of promotion about that for the sake of those listening who really need some direction, and perhaps Rock Harbor Church can give them that direction?
Sure. We've talked about this before. The biggest questions we always get is, I can't find a church in my area. So what we decided to do is try to help the remnant, helping them find churches in their areas. And so we have put together on our staff guys who are willing to do some research for these people, to search out the area, at least through online, and see the statement of faith or the churches surrounding them. And then what we do is we recommend that they go, and then they report back to us in a kind of a reconnaissance of, okay, what did you find when you talked to the pastor? Does the pastor match what the statement is online? What we were able to do is start locating fairly decent churches around the nation. And we're working on a plugin for our website eventually that's going to have the ability to show people on a map in the United States where some good churches are that we have identified. Now, they might have to drive to them a ways away, but at least we can tell them, here's a church in your area. So people have emailed us, and we are doing our best to help them in finding churches. If we can't, sometimes we recommend them starting a Bible study, and we equip them with commentaries or whatever we need to supply, because this is the problem out there. It's like a wasteland.
Yeah.
So we have decided to try to help them out.
Best email then for that would be?
info@rockharborchurch.net.
info@rockharborchurch.net. You might not get directly connected to Pastor Brandon Holthouse, but he's got a staff who's willing to help you as much as they can. Brandon, you know, another year is winding down here. And by the way, thank you for what you're doing. I just personally want to thank you from the remnant believers out in listener land. They are so appreciative that somebody would care that much to help them get plugged in. Our year is winding down. We got another couple of months left, but I'd like your take, and I'm down to about 3 minutes here. Your take on the current year, what when it comes to things that the Bible predicted, which, of course, that's legions of things. So we're seeing things break in the headlines on a daily basis that I think have end time significance. But if you could pick one or two issues here for 2021 that have some biblical significance, what would they be?
Jan, I think the big takeaway from last year is the vaccine mandates.
I agree.
That was a watershed event that's continuing on, and we're watching authoritarian, totalitarian types of things happen from this to where it's not your choice anymore that you can get vaccinated. It's a demand, and you will lose your job for it. And then we see scenes in Australia of a police state that's developed there. And can that police state develop here in America if they start forcing this on people and not taking religious exemptions or medical exemptions? What has this turned into? It has turned into a totalitarian play to capture our rights. And I think that is the biggest thing people need to realize. The other thing to realize is how many people were willing to give up their rights for mandates. And I'm not making the point of whether people should be vaccinated or not. I'm just saying it's wrong when a government tells you you have to do something and violate your own personal rights. That's the problem. And they're not going to stop. They're going to continue on, because after this, they're going to marry these mandates to the ability to travel, the ability to go state to state, and the ability to go into stores and be just a part of society. Yeah. And what's happening now is the unvaccinated are being considered the untouchables, the unclean. A two-tiered society is developing from this. And that's what should concern everybody, because the unvaccinated are looking to be persecuted and segregated from society because of their status.
Well, I couldn't agree with you more, Brandon. I didn't think I'd ever see the day where I'm witnessing some of the things that we're talking about. I think back a year and a half ago, it was, let's have 15 days to slow the spread, and that turned into virtual tyranny. As you said, parts of Australia is completely under jackbooted thugs almost in that continent. Canada's getting close to that. Parts of Europe are getting close to complete tyranny over some of these mandates. Evil just seems to be running amok. I think what I want to do is I want to close the program just reading a couple of scriptures, because we've talked about evil for this whole hour. And what does God think of those that are coming up with the most incredibly evil schemes, these globalists, these one-worlders? I think he's got a message to them in Psalm 2. And there we read, "Why do the nations conspire and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and his anointed, saying, let us burst their bonds asunder and cast their cords from us. He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord has them in derision. Then he will speak to them in his wrath and terrify them in his fury, saying, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill." I hope that encouraged you, folks, because God is sitting in the heavens laughing at these evildoers, and he has a very ignominious future for them. Sad to say, I want to thank you for listening, and we will talk to you again next week.
Contact us through our website, olivetreeviews.org. That's olivetreeviews.org. Call us Central Time at 763-559-4444. That's 763-559-4444. You get our mail when you write to Olive Tree Ministries and Jan Markell, Box 1452, Maple Grove, Minnesota, 55311. That's Box 1452, Maple Grove, Minnesota, 55311. All gifts are tax deductible. These are challenging and perilous times, just as the Bible predicted. But last day's events must play out so that all things can fall into place.